So I was tasked with doing the overview of all of prostate cancer, for which there are multiple books and chapters and thousands of papers. So I'll try to cram all that into 13 minutes and we'll see how we go. So I'll start with the burden of prostate cancer, give updates on the early detection guidelines, talk a little bit about treatment options, life after, and acknowledging some of the issues and takeaways. This will be as kind of a teaser for what's to come for the rest of the day. So the burden of prostate cancer, we know overall nearly 300,000 will be estimated diagnosed with prostate cancer this year alone, with about 35,000 deaths attributed to prostate cancer estimated for this year. Since 2014, those cases have continued to rise, ranging from 3 to 5% per year. And we've seen increases in those who are being diagnosed with disease that is regional or distant, meaning that it is outside the prostate, close to the prostate, but outside, or beyond the prostate and beyond the pelvis, beyond the hips. And we know that the amount of disease that we're finding within the prostate is starting to increase over time. So these are things that we need to start addressing now before we start seeing the end results 5-10 years later as these things develop and progress. We know that that risk is not the same for every group, every population. So we know, and it's been well documented, that there are groups of men like Black men who are at higher risk than other groups. And there's many different factors going into that. But we know that everyone's risk is something that should be understood and addressed. And we know that there are factors beyond just the biology, the tissue in and of itself, that are impacting the outcomes that we're seeing. So we need to understand not only the biology, but where people are getting care, hopefully getting it in a timely fashion and appropriate care to treat it early enough to where we can cure it. We're seeing that these factors are a meshwork. They're not really one thing independent of everything else. They're playing into each other. So where people live, where they thrive, is impacting biology in the other way around. Now, I'll just jump to detection guidelines as we go through all of the literature for prostate cancer. Now, our guidelines give us an idea of how we should evaluate men who may be at risk for prostate cancer, and then beyond, once they're diagnosed, what we should do next. And oftentimes people think, okay, well, I need the finger exam, what I call the urologist handshake, and then I'm going to get a biopsy and that's it. Thankfully, things have evolved past that. We've moved past the handshake as our first step, but it's starting with just knowing your own family history, knowing what that PSA test, the blood test is. Those numbers and that information in and of itself give us information to help us understand what's your risk of having prostate cancer at all, and what's your risk of having prostate cancer that we should treat now rather than 5 or 10 years from now. And busy slide, but this shows us that there's an algorithm at play now. There's a clear way for us to evaluate men, and that it starts with a blood test rather than what we used to use before that handshake. And not only after the blood test, we also have other things that we can do before and after a biopsy, that invasive procedure, to understand where your risk is. Because thankfully, it's no longer a you have it or you don't, but it's do you have it? Do you have a low grade, low risk type? Or do you have a high grade type that needs treatment up front? And there are different tests that we can do both before the invasive biopsy or afterwards to better understand that risk for each of those things. One of those includes an MRI or imaging of the prostate to give us an idea of how big your prostate is. So is your PSA higher because your prostate's large, or is there something abnormal within the prostate that's very suspicious for that clinically significant prostate cancer, that type of treatment, that type of prostate cancer that needs treatment early? And that can now inform the biopsy better than it has in the past. I kind of call this the Pokemon Go of prostate biopsies, where now we have different images that we can put on top of each other to better target the things that may be suspicious and hiding within the prostate itself. Our goal there is really to, again, find cancer that may impact lifespan. And again, there are different things that we can do even after the biopsy to better understand what's happening in the prostate itself, in the cancer, in the cancer's DNA. And all of those things allow us to understand how best to treat you. In a large graph that no one other than me and a few others have to memorize, but what it does show you is that once we have all of that information, there's a clear path forward of how we should treat that. And it's based on all of the information that we gather. We put it all together and it helps us understand where you are on the spectrum of disease. helps us understand what treatments may give you the best chance of cure, best survival impact. And that's the purpose of the guidelines. That's the purpose of these large groups of men and women coming together, talking about what's been published, what studies have been done to show what would be helpful. And sometimes that may not be just one treatment. It may be a combination of treatments, but it does give us an idea of what would be needed. Now, oftentimes people think of treatment as kind of one and done, I'm good, see you, Dr. Washington, never again. But there are things that have to happen afterwards. And there are things that have to happen after you get diagnosed. You need to talk with the teams that would help take care of you. And thankfully, I'm at a place where I've kind of grown up in the idea of a multidisciplinary team. So even if you're someone seeing one of us for surgery, you'll still have that opportunity to talk with the radiation oncology colleagues, to talk about what the other treatments may look like. And for some men, it may require each of our teams coming together to help treat you. So it's not just what I want, it's what you want and how our team can best serve you. I tried to capture everyone who's here today, but the different options will depend again on what type of cancer we find and where you are on that risk spectrum. And we'll have opportunities to go over all of those later today as well. Again, sorry for my voice. One of those is active surveillance. And it's not really active surveillance in and of itself, but do you need treatment now? Or can we safely surveil this disease and identify it when there are small changes, still giving you that opportunity for cure, but without the upfront cost of side effects related to treatment? And that's why the initial assessment is so important. And we'll go over this further, but all of those tests that we talk about gives us a better idea, again, where you are on that spectrum to understand if active surveillance is appropriate for you or if you need some other opportunity or other treatment. And the goal here is really to delay some of the impact of treatment until it's necessary, but still not sacrificing the opportunity for cure. And we know even after treatment, regardless of the type that you receive, we have to see how that's impacting your quality of life afterwards. And I think everyone's heard at least something about the impact of sexual function, impact on sexual function and urine control, depending on the type of treatment that people receive. So that's an active part of the discussion, in addition to us talking about the cancer in the PSA. Both of those things come together. They're interlinked. And all of those things impact quality of life after the treatment. But that path, that trajectory for each person will depend on where they start out with and what treatments they get. So that's the part that we need to discuss and tailor for everyone. And we know that it is not a single visit after surgery and then you're done. You'll still see us for lab tests. Some people may need additional testing. Some people may need additional imaging tests. So it's a long-term relationship that will happen from the minute you get the first PSA to seeing any of us to discuss treatments. So I just want to stress that it is a long-term partnership to help us help you in manage this disease. Thank you. Hopefully that's within time. Yeah, so I'll repeat the question for people online. Tests that are coming out now that could replace a biopsy or help predict what will happen in the future. And I think there's a lot of efforts looking at this right now. We don't have one silver bullet, one perfect test right now, but it's an exciting area of research. A lot of the tests that we use now help us understand where you are on the risk spectrum. I think Dr. Carroll will add something to that as well.
So I was on the FDA panel for the GRAIL test and other multi-gene detection tests. That test is really not focused so much on prostate cancer, but the big worldwide burden of the cancers that don't have a screening test like PSA mammography. These would be like pancreatic cancer, liver cancer. So I think that test, and that test is interesting because it not only tells you your risk of having a cold cancer, it'll tell you where that cancer may be, where the other multi-gene detection tests don't localize the area. But actually, PSA is a great test when it comes to prostate cancer. It's sensitive but not specific, and I think that's where you went in, Sam, to talk a little bit about the secondary testing, but I think GRAIL is focused on this burden that probably 60% of the overall world mortality does not have, cancers do not have a test like PSA. That's what they focus on. And these are rare cancers, so the incidence levels are low, but globally it's a high burden.
Since we're talking about testing, although you can defer this, Prostox, from my reading, is relatively new for as an assay to evaluate susceptibility to radiation. Where is that in the whole spectrum of viability, applicability?
I may have Dr. Carroll. I may moderate this more than anything else.
Just had a big discussion on this.
Yeah, so for those of you that don't know, it's an assay that's recently been developed to predict toxicity. And what I've seen published in JAMA was GU toxicity, but I suspect that it would predict toxicity in other areas. GU means urinary symptoms. And in the one study using stereotactic body radiotherapy, it seemed to separate out people that had more toxicity than others. And it is available. I've sent some patients, they will do it for free currently, where you, if you're referred to them, they will send you a kit, and then you give a specimen, sputum or something, and you send it back to them, and then they'll give you an analysis. Now, I've had it run on several patients who I thought had higher than expected toxicity, and my impression is that there seemed to be a correlation. So it's very early. It's not been validated with large numbers of patients, but it is something that is being developed.
Thanks, Mac.